So the analogy here is the missiness mechanism is, again, it's this correlation, it's this trajectory of the y's. You have to build upon that, which means you need to model the correlation structure correctly to appropriately adjust for the missiness mechanism. And this is clearly not doing it, right? It's treating everything as independent. It's not borrowing any information off of the within-subject correlation in those y's. So I'm not adjusting for the missiness mechanism, which basically means this analysis is like non-ignorable missiness. Right? It's like this is if I had never measured the thing that led to the missiness, because I'm not adjusting for it, I'm not accounting for it in the model. You guys with me on that? Now, the nice thing is, this is the correct variance-covariance structure. This is a misspecified variance-covariance structure. By doing something relatively crude, you can get back most of the bias, so to speak, that was sitting there. And the truth there is minus n. You guys will have seen probably a little bit more bias when you did the 450, but you can see that you gain back most of that bias. And maybe decrease, I should say, most of that bias. But again, trying to emphasize to you guys, so there's two main reasons why you do EDA and the variance covariance structure to get something realistic. One is the efficiency, you saw that up top. Two is that if you've got kind of missing at random data, the missiness is dependent upon the value of your trajectory, if you will, the shape of your trajectory, then you're going to want to have some reasonable estimate of that weighting scheme to reduce bias in the coefficient estimates. You guys with me on that? Yeah, so there's a couple of things I would say there, Ina. So you notice that I didn't actually ask you guys to look at efficiency here.
No, yeah.
Right? Why did I not ask? I'm going to answer your question in just a second, but first I want to make explicit why I did not ask you to compare efficiencies across these things. They're not consistent for the same quantity, right? So again, when we talk about comparing variances across estimators, we want them to be estimating the exact same quantity, and then you say, okay, which one can do it better? What I'm saying here is I'm really estimating three different quantities here, right? These are biased for different values, right? This one's unbiased on the far right. That's the correct weighting scheme. But the other two have a little bit of bias in them. So that's the reason why I didn't ask you to compare efficiencies on this. It doesn't really make sense to compare second moments to the first moment. It's the same across an estimator. So that's part of what's happening that you're seeing, though. You know, I mean, so feeding into this is because these things are estimating different quantities, you wouldn't necessarily expect them to have the same variances. Yeah.
But I just wanted to compare WS1 and WS2.
They're kind of close. I get what you're saying, but technically, WS1 is still biased. Right. It's not consistent with the same quantity. It's because it's misspecified. I haven't fully adjusted. It has reduced the bias a lot. I mean, that's from a practical standpoint, when you're thinking about doing things. If WS1 did not reduce the bias to a large degree, that would be a very scary situation for statistics. You see what I'm saying? Because take your FEV data, take your CD4 count data. Do you have a missingness mechanism that is akin to what you generated here? Take the max CD4 count data. Yes or no? The answer is I have no idea, right? I mean, I don't know, you know, when I see a subject and he's coming back every 6 months and I've got him for 7 measures and then all of a sudden I don't see any measurement on him. I have no idea what happened. Maybe the study ended. Maybe he moved out of state. Maybe his CD4 count dropped so low that he won't come back anymore. Which would be more akin to this, right? I mean, so the answer is, in practice, I don't know generally, right? In an observational study, when you start seeing these repeated measures and then all of a sudden they don't show up anymore, unless you've collected specifically that information, you're never going to know that. And so the reason why I'm saying if that didn't reduce a lot of the bias, that would be a very scary situation, because most of the time we have no idea you got to formulate this setting through simulation, but you don't really know that. Now, I agree with you that in the max example, you could postulate pretty reasonably that that might be happening, right? I mean, this is something where your CD4 is really measuring your immune system. And as people's CD4 counts are dropping below particular points, they're getting very sick. They can't fight off infection. So that would be a pretty good reason not to be coming back to these visits. So, So it's a very likely scenario to have there, and so we should probably make your adjustments for the Pilgrim structure. Okay. Any
question?
Yeah. No, so missing completely at random just decreases variance, right? Because it's like you have a random sample of the population still, it's just you have fewer of those samples, right? So missing completely at random, like the 25% case, that's actually okay. But again, in practice, do you ever know if you're missing completely at random, missing at random, or not at normal? You don't. I mean, because the last category is the one that's by definition unanswerable, right? Because it says, by definition, you have no information on the Acinus mechanism, so there's nothing in your data that can tell you one way or the other. Now, you can eliminate missing completely at random in a data set empirically. In other words, you could look at your data set and say, the people that have more missing values for the responses tend to be older. Well, that means that there's something that's influencing the missingness, right? So it's not missing completely at random anymore. It tends to be people that are of a higher age, for example. But that doesn't tell you that also, it's dependent upon their higher age and the fact that, you know, they have more than a high school education. You know, making this up, or you didn't measure education, in which case that's not relevant. You wouldn't be able to. But yeah, missing completely at random is like the warm and fuzzy feeling that we all want to believe that we're looking in when we have missing data. I mean, it really is. It's like, oh yeah, you know, it's missing completely at random. Everything looks out. It's like, I got a random sample of the population. But no guarantees on that. And look, 9 times out of 10, that's not going to be the case. I mean, if you just think intuitively with common sense about why people might or might not come in back for a study, or if you're thinking about classrooms where you're measuring them, or you're thinking about businesses where they're reporting data or survey data, for example, there are reasons why people are not returning questionnaires usually. It's not just random. Okay. So hopefully we learned some things there. Again, part of this was to motivate the importance of doing the UVA and the variance covariance structure. All right, so now you guys have a homework assignment that just now came out. Let me just bring it up here. It's hot off the presses, so it's not actually up on the left page. But two problems, though. I want to give you guys plenty of time to study for the midterm as well. I didn't want you to be bored. So the first problem, actually quite simple. You've actually done most of the work for this problem. Okay, so what I want you to do is go back and consider those simulation settings that I just now talked about where you plotted the spaghetti plots for individuals under different variance covariance structures. And then just simply plot, just simulate one data set for each scenario, and then construct an empirical variogram. And then comment on the features of that empirical variogram about what you know about the underlying variance covariance process that's sitting there. So again, trying to tune your eye, if you will, to what you're seeing in the variogram plots under known scenarios. The only scenario that I added, thanks to Monticello Cruz, you know, up in the back, is I actually asked you guys to also generate one single data set where you just have independence. So what should the variogram look like if you just have independence? We'll try box. It'll be a flat line at total variation. It'll be a flat line at total variation. That's what it should be. So take a look at it and see. Okay. And again, make sure that that is intuitive to you or that you're understanding why I'm saying that, that it should be a flat line at total. There is no serial process, there is no random intercept process, and the measure and error is all getting sunk in with everything else. Okay. So that's hopefully what you will see there. The second problem, I actually think, is a very enlightening problem. So it's not trivial, I'm going to warn you guys right now. It looks trivial, right? So I'm giving you a scenario where you've got this designed experiment. And what you've got in your designed experiment is, think you can take people as the example here. So you give everybody, you take a baseline measurement on everyone. So let's say blood pressure again, it's easy to think about. So I bring you guys all in. I get your blood pressures, I measure them, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to assign randomly half of you to treatment and half of you to control, and I'm going to measure your blood pressure after some period of time. You've been on the medication. And so that's called a classic pre-post design, right? right? So I've got a pre-measurement on everybody here, and then I've got a post-measurement on everybody after some of you had treatment and some of you have not had treatment. I'm going to ask you guys to think about three different models for estimating the treatment effect. Now, the treatment effect is the within subject change in blood pressure, right? I mean, that's the natural thing. You know what the pre is, you know what the post is, how much does the treatment lower the blood pressure on a person? So you're going to look at a few different models. So one just simply says, I'll take the treatment indicator, that's my predictor of interest. I'll take the measurement of, or an indicator, I should say, of whether the measurement was post, and then I'll take an interaction between these two. So notice that this thing is a correlated data multivariate response model, right? So I got YIJ. In other words, I'm treating the pre as an outcome, and I'm treating the post as an outcome, and I've got an indicator for pre or post in my model. So I want you to just interpret for me what this gamma is, and hopefully that will lead to some intuition about the scientific question of interest, which is this within subject change. And then I'm going to have you say, okay, well, suppose you use this model and then you assumed an exchangeable covariance matrix, which is what you would do in this case, right? Because there's only two measurements. So it's just one correlation that's off the diagonal. So it's exchangeable by definition. Okay. And so if you did that, tell me what the MLEs are and calculate the variance in that case. And then I want you guys to consider another model, though. And the other model I want you to consider is one where you use the fact that you randomized. So if I randomize, that means that the expected value pre for people that received control is the same as the expected value pre for people that received treatment, because it's randomized, right? I mean, so it should be equally balanced across the two groups. If you use that fact, you can reduce that top model to something that just looks like an adjustment for post and an adjustment for treatment times the interaction with post. And then I want you to, again, give me an interpretation there and make sure that we're still estimating the same thing. Then I want you to derive the MLE for that model. Again, in a normal situation where you assume Y to be normal, just making it easy for you with homo stochastic errors. That's written at the top of the problem. Calculate its variance. And at the end of the day, I want you to realize that both of those estimators that come out of there from the repeated measures design or this thing here for you guys, you might want to write this down because I didn't actually write it there. This is in the literature called an ANCOVA model. People said, I have a pre-post design and I fit an ANCOVA model, that's it. Okay. So I want you to realize that the repeated measures estimator and the ANCOVA model estimator both have a form. And they have a form that looks like, what's the mean within subject change, post minus pre for people that took treatment, subtracting mean within subject change, post minus pre for people that had control. Right? That's the scientific question of interest. Ah, well, let's see here. If I take alpha equal to 1, what is my test? What is my model actually reduce down to? So in other words, I take the average within subject change for group 1 minus the average within subject change for group 2. That's the pair t-test, right? You guys with me on that? That just takes the pairwise differences. Takes the difference in those means, exactly. You're going to see that alpha is going to be different from some of these other models, though. And whatever that alpha is going to play into the variance. See some pretty interesting things, I think, in terms of how to build these models relative to the efficiency that you can gain back. You've got a randomized pre-post design. Okay? So again, it's sticking with the same theme that we have been sticking with, which is how do you use correlation to your advantage in a study, okay? To gain back efficiency while still estimating the same quantity. So you guys will look at that at the end of the day and give me kind of some summary wrap-ups there. You'll do it all kind of mathematically. Okay. So just two problems. Okay, the last one's A through G, but two problems. Weight, so to speak, on the sign. Yep. when I'm writing the bar, that just means the mean.
Okay, so let's move on, let's kind of finish off lecture 9 today, some fun stuff to you here. So, again, with lecture 9, we kind of bringing in a new way of estimation, right? The idea was we've been doing method of moments estimation on the grain coping structure. That was the GDCP process. And now we're going to kind of a fully parametric process where I'm thinking about parameterizing the correlation or covariance structure in terms of random effects and then residual error here, and then actually putting distributions on those things, right? So now that I've put fully specified distributions on these things, I can then formulate a likelihood and I can do maximum likelihood estimation. That's what I mean by parametric. Everything is becoming parameterized here. So no more method of moments estimation. So last time we talked a little bit about the interpretation again of these random effects models. Again, there is interpretation in the variance covariance for the random effects, and I talked about in each particular setting, right? In terms of the intercept, the slope, and then the covariance between the two. Then we said, well, okay, once you've defined up the random effects that are there, you've got this residual error. So in other words, the error structure conditional upon the ith sampling unit's random effects. The most popular thing for people to do, this is will not surprise you, this is the easiest thing for them to do, which is to say, conditional upon the random effects, I'll just assume that the measurement errors now are completely independent, okay, that they're just random draws now from that person. In other words, the way you can think about that intuitively is if I've adjusted for my individual random effect, then I've adjusted for everything that makes me different from the rest of the population, so now all this looks like random noise, okay? But we've been dealing with things like measurements over time, so you might expect, even if I adjust for my random effect, I might still have some correlation between observations that are closer in time versus those that are farther away in time, even on myself. So that's where you might say, okay, I'll entertain, for example, an autoregressive process on that residual error, and I talked about the two that we've already seen here, these are kind of the most popular autoregressive structures. And then finally, you can go back to that old Diggle model, which tries to encompass really the three major components, kind of this random intercept, if you will, the trait of an individual to be high versus low, and then some serial process, which is kind of the state of the individual, how is the correlation changing as a function of time as I move away from two measurements. And then finally, a measurement error that just says, look, devices, the things that we use to measure on an individual are not often perfect. In other words, they're not perfectly reproducible. And so that's that measurement error that's caught up at the end of the day here. And so I talked a little bit about that guy. So now, realize though, that we're still back in the same old days where I've got this variance of a vector-based response. But now I've taken that variance covariance structure, I've parameterized it with a finite set of parameters, I'm calling those alpha now, and alpha consists of the parameters that make up capital D and RI, okay, on each individual. And so, with that knowledge though, and realizing that if I put a multivariate normal distribution, or if I assume a multivariate normal distribution for the little b and for the epsilon, then, well, that means my y's are multivariate normal. They have variance covariance structure equal to that sigma I of alpha, and they have mean equal to xi times beta. That's my systematic component. Everybody with me so far? Good, all right. So if I know that, I've got a PDF for these guys. I can write down the likelihood. So the product here is because of the fact that I've got independent sampling units, right? So I'm borrowing information off of those independent sampling units. Notice that this alpha does not depend upon I. I'm not estimating variance components for the ith individual. I'm estimating them across the population. You guys with me? Where does the little I have a little I there though. What is that relatable? why am I technically, do I need to write that?
Maybe it's imbalanced.
Could be imbalanced, so the sigmas could be of different size. What else? Exactly. If I'm in an autoregressive process, right, Hina, I might have different timings of those measurements across individuals. In other words, everybody can share a common row, but that difference in time might be different across individuals. So they're going to have a different covariance coefficient. That's why I'm writing the little I there at the end of the day. Okay. But the parameters, the underlying parameters, again, it just so that you know, statistics are horribly intuitive. All you're doing is you're saying I'm going to put structure on this and borrow off of my independent clusters as I go estimate these parameters off. But this is great now. We can actually write down that PDF, which means we can write down that likelihood. So the PDF is just looking like your good old multivariate normal. We're used to seeing this at this point. So from that multivariate normal, I can come up with my square equations. Just take the derivative of the log likelihood. That's going to give me something that looks like xi transpose sigma inverse times y minus x. And does that look familiar to everybody? I certainly hope so, right? I mean, you guys have been doing it now for about a year. So that's just giving rise to weighted least squares again, right? I mean, that's all it's doing. The key thing now, though, so we've been doing this process, but we have been using moment-based estimates of these alphas that are sitting inside there based upon the residuals, just simple method of moments estimates. Now we can say, I can solve for the MLE for those alphas now because I've got a likelihood. That likelihood is a function of those alphas. So what I can do is I can say, what I need to do is maximize the log likelihood for alpha. And what we do is we call it the profile log likelihood. Have you guys heard that terminology before? That might be new terminology. But profile log likelihood simply means I'll take the MLE for one estimate, and I'll just plug it in and fix it. Well, then I'll maximize the log likelihood for the other parameter that I mentioned. Okay? So the profile log likelihood here for alpha is nothing more than the log likelihood for the multivariate normal, but I'm fixing beta now at my MLE. Now, you guys are saying, yeah, but your estimate of beta depends upon alpha, right? So what would you be doing? Like myself, iterating, just like you're doing. But again, terminology for you guys, that's why I have it italicized. When you hear people talk about profile log likelihood, they mean you've got multiple parameters. You're going to condition upon the value of a parameter and then maximize the log likelihood for the other parameter of interest. Yeah? What was that? You can do an EM algorithm for this, but you can also do it iteratively in this case. You can just get your estimate plugged back in. But yes, in many cases for profile log likelihood, people will do EM. Okay, so they can get up on that side. Okay. Good. So now, this is what I kind of alluded to last time. I mean, we can write these things down. We can actually maximize these. Not too big of a problem. But we need to realize, though, that when we maximize this profile log likelihood that's sitting down here, that does not account for the fact that we've got an estimate sitting here. Okay, and you guys, again, have been doing this all along. Like when you told me about your MSC back in 2010, you said it's the sum of squared residuals divided by n minus p. That's not the MLE. The MLE is the sum of squared residuals divided by n. You were subtracting off the p because you were accounting for the fact that you had estimated beta hat in the new model there. And then that induced bias, okay, in your MLE estimate. And so the n minus p was a correction for that bias. Okay? So the same thing is happening here. When I maximize that profile log likelihood, I'm not accounting for the fact that beta hat is being estimated. Right? I'm just sticking it in, treating it as fixed. Okay? That's going to induce bias. So now, let's look at a little example. In the easiest place is like the balanced and complete data case, where I can show you guys what the bias term is here. So let's write this down. So let's start with our good old weight of least squares estimator. Right? So that's beta hat g. If you're in the balanced and complete case, you've got sum I equal 1 to capital N, that's my sampling units, xi transpose sigma I inverse xi. This whole thing to a minus 1 sitting up here. Sum I equal 1 to capital N, xi transpose, sigma I, yi. So, known covariance, write that thing down, that's the optimal estimate, that is the MLE in fact. So now you say, okay, but I have to estimate sigma. Well, the maximum likelihood estimator for sigma in the balanced and complete case is exactly what you would expect. It's the sum of squared residuals divided by n. Well, it's the sum of squares that are abusive determinants. We're talking about vectors here, but it's the outer product. So it's going to be yi minus xi times beta hat. And if it's okay with you guys, I'm going to just drop, because I'm going to be writing a lot here, I'm going to drop the little g. Okay, so can you guys put a note? Residuals, there's residual transpose, that's going to give me the ith estimate, if you will, of the variance covariance, and I'm just averaging across everything for a common variance covariance. Okay? And that's what the MLE is going to be in the balanced and complete case. Everything gets equal with you. So now, if I look at the expectation of that maximum likelihood estimate, it looks like 1 over capital N, I equal 1 to n, expectation now of y on minus xi beta hat, y on minus xi beta hat transpose. Far so good. Expectation is linear. So now, let's go ahead and multiply this guy out of it. That's the expectation, 1 over n sum I equal 1 to n. Expectation of, now what I'm going to have, I'm just going to do a little add and subtract. I'm going to go on yi minus xi beta, that's the true beta, that doesn't have a hat on it. Plus, I'm going to add in an xi beta. So that's just 0 that I'm pulling into my model, minus an xi beta hat, and that guy is going to be multiplied by, I'm going to do the same thing for the second factor. Adding and subtracting the mean of this and the mean of this. Okay. So now, if I look at that guy, I'm going to get 1 over n sum I equal 1 to n. Oh!
the nice things are going to happen, right? When I take this guy and I hit it times this guy, do the multiplication through, and then run my expectation through, what do I have? I have the variance of yi, right? So the expectation of yi minus its mean times y minus its mean transpose. Oops, not expectation, variance. Perfect. And then minus, I'm going to get a 2 times xi times the covariance of yi on the cross product. Oops, covariance of yi, big hat, sorry. On the cross product. And then I'm going to get a plus variance of this guy here, which is going to be an xi times variance of beta hat times an xi transpose. And this whole thing is inside of that sum. So that's just multiplying out each of these two term factors. Okay. So now, this is 1 over n, sum I equal 1 to n. Well, this thing here is sigma I. That's not j, that's I. It's the notation that we're using there. That's variance of yi. This thing that's sitting here is minus 2 times xi, that's what's sitting out front, but then I'm going to get a sum I equal 1 to n xi transpose sigma I inverse xi inverse xi transpose sigma I inverse times a variance of yi. That's coming from the second covariance. Hopefully we're all seeing that. This is just this is linear in the y's, right? So it's just a constant times y, so that constant gets pulled out to give up the variance of y. And then finally, for this last term, I get a plus xi. Well, let's see, what's the variance of beta hat in this case? This is just a study question for you guys' exam. Xi transpose sigma I inverse, that's the correct weight, right? Xi all inverse. You guys with me? Good. Again, back that nice usual form that you had from your last days. And then finally I have an Xi transpose sitting off on the end. Everything is inside of that sum, that curly bracket that's sitting there. Okay? Good. Well, couple of nice things happen anyways. This guy that's sitting here is the identity, right? That's just sigma I inverse times sigma I. So that part's okay. And so what I have then is I have minus 2 of this guy plus 1 more of those guys. So that expectation then looks like, well, let's see, let's start wrapping the sum in. So I would get capital N of these things. Oh, you know what I've been doing all along and I shouldn't have been doing? What am I using in the balanced and complete case? I'm still putting some structure on the model, right? Do I want an I on all those? I got carried away with all my I's. You got to put some structure on the model, right? That's the idea of the balanced and complete case. You got to borrow some information off of it. We're going to assume we got a common. I apologize, guys. Common zero. Okay, all the way to that's why, by the way, that's why the MLE is just taking the average of all. Okay, so they're all common, they're all the same. So drop 1 there. That's going to be sigma I still. That's sigma I. That's sigma I. And that guy there. You see where it wasn't going to work out? It was right here. Because I'm going to bring that sum in. I'll get capital N times this guy. Divide by N. So that leaves me with this sigma out front. And then a minus xi sum I equal 1 to capital N
xi transpose sigma xi inverse and xi transpose. And so that guy there is a bias, right? Because what I'd like to have is when I take the expectation of that estimator, I just get back sigma. But I don't get back sigma minus this term that's sitting over here. Okay, so that's the bias that would be coming if you don't account for the fact that you have estimated beta hat. So you can pull the MLD for sigma. Okay? Have you guys seen something similar to this? It's a trick question, because you probably have, right? I mean, did you guys ever show the bias in just the normal squared model? You did the exact same trick. You did the same add and subtract. And just now you're doing it in integers. Okay. So, Houston, we have a problem, right? So we've got to deal with that. We've got bias here. So if we want unbiased estimates of those variance components, we're going to have to do something different. Wednesday, 6th week. Okay. Any more cycles? Okay, thank you guys for the careful watch. Alright, so now, Rebecca's non-zero terms over there, so how can we deal with that? Well, potentially a new concept for you guys. I'm not sure, you may have seen something like this in 200B, possibly. The idea is we're going to go to something called a restricted maximum likelihood estimation. And really, when it was first introduced, and I'll tell you where the origin comes from, so people will refer to it as RML, right? So R-M-L-E, right? So RML. But really, the restricted, which has become known as, it started off as residual maximum likelihood estimation. And I'll show you guys why. So we're going to build kind of a likelihood around the residual. But here's the basic premise. The basic premise says, look, if you've got a likelihood that's a function of two parameters, right, where you've got a parameter of interest, I'll call that lambda, and then you've got another parameter that's a nuisance parameter that you basically got to deal with, okay? And you want to do estimation here. Well, if you can decompose that model, first of all, in terms of minimal sufficient statistics, so there is a reason why you did all that stuff back in 200. Okay. In other words, you're not losing data, or information, I should say, in your data by doing data reduction. And you can factor then that likelihood into two components. One component that only depends upon lambda, that's the thing that you care about. And then the other component that depends upon both lambda and, in this case, what I'm calling phi. Then you can base estimation just upon the first component of that guy, right? So now, this only depends upon lambda, so I'll just use the information in S1 to estimate lambda. I throw away a bit of information when doing that, but I don't have to worry about the estimation of phi anymore in doing it, because I've just decomposed this thing down to where it's only dependent, that first portion is only dependent upon lambda. Okay? So we call that the marginal likelihood. Okay. So that way, inference can be just based upon this marginal likelihood that's sitting here. A very similar thing occurs in, for example, survival analysis, where the Cox partial likelihood came from. So you marginalize the likelihood over the event times and the sensory.
times for those of you that have any familiarity with that, maybe taking Bitnami's class right now. So we use this trick quite a lot when we basically want to get rid of nuisance parameters and not deal with the bias that's induced by having them estimated inside of the model. Now, in our particular case, normally what I told you guys in this class is you're interested in beta, and sigma is the nuisance parameter. It's the thing you got to deal with to draw inference on the betas. But right now, I'm focusing on trying to get a good estimate of sigma. And so what's playing the role of sigma, so to speak, is the lambda here. That's the thing I care about, and I want to get rid of the betas for a second. I don't want to have to deal with the fact that I estimated the sigma. Okay, because that's where the bias was coming in. So, sure, let's do it. You guys might need some paper for this. Let's write down the derivation of Rimmel via marginal likelihood. And for those of you guys taking 200C, this will be a very good 200C review.
Test today?
Today.
No, they have a test today.
You have a test today. Well, okay. Is that why nobody's here?
Yeah.
Talk to Jazza. She makes her class too hard. That's horrible. You guys are all getting extra credit, and I hope you do very, very well. We need to be prepped and tuned to this. So. Again, you probably want some extra paper for this one. So this is the derivation of Rimmel via marginal likelihood. Skipping class to study for a midterm. So again, to derive a marginal likelihood, we need a function of the beta. So you guys get some intuition behind this. I'll call that u, which is going to be some function of my responses y. For the distribution of u, does not depend on beta in our. And so we're trying to get at some function that we can step back and say, I won't have to worry about the fact that I estimated beta in order to get draw estimates for C. Okay. So in order to do this, let's just write it over here. Maybe we'll put all this stuff on your guidance, Ben. Don't share your notes. Ben, don't post this yet.
Got it. Great.
So, as an aside, I want you guys to become friendly with this terminology of an error contrast matrix. And an error contrast matrix, in the case of our problem, is going to be defined as some C, or CY really, where the expectation of C times Y is equal to the zero vector. And so let's note for a second.
So you guys can kind of see where the idea of an error contrast, right? I mean, think about terminology. Errors, we think about it having mean zero, right? You're centered off. Contrasts, well, I'm taking linear contrasts across these y's. Okay, so that's the terminology. Okay, so note that for the LME model now, this linear mixed effects model, if I can find this C such that E, the expectation of C times Y is equal to zero for any beta, that happens if and only if C times X is equal to zero. Right, because the expectation of Y is just X times beta, and if that's holding for any beta, then I have to have that X times, or C times X has got to be zero. Right? Beta can certainly be non-zero. And so further, if CX is equal to zero, then C times Y and the notation that I've been using in my notes is going to be equal to C times Z times, the matrix Z, that's the design matrix for the random effects, plus C times epsilon, individual errors, right? Because C times Y look like X beta times Z little b plus epsilon. So just running the C through with C times X is equal to zero. Okay. Now a nice thing about this is it's a transformation of Y. It's a function of Y. And it does not depend upon beta. So that's what we're shooting for. That's at G of Y. Right? Okay. We just got to go find the C. Note that this does not depend on beta. It's not. Okay. So now, this is where linear models are so cool, right? So there are so many tricks you can do with a linear model. It's just so let's consider the hat matrix. I told you there was going to be relevance to 200C. Beginning. What's the hat matrix? Well, it looks like X, times X transpose X inverse, as in the good old OLS case, times X transpose. It could be in the general linear model case where you're just sinking everything into the X as well. And let's define B, and I'm going to start throwing down some dimensions so you guys can keep me honest here. So the dimensions on this thing are going to be N, actually I'm going to write it like this, N times N minus B. You know what? Actually, I'm not. I'm going to write it as capital N. Sorry. It's going to be the total number of observations that I have. So total number of clusters times the observations within a cluster. And we'll define that B such that number one, I minus the hat matrix is equal to B times B transpose. And B transpose times B is equal to the identity matrix that has dimension N minus P by N minus P. So pop quiz for you folks taking 200C. Why do I know that B exists? It's the spectral decomposition theorem, right? Spectral decomposition theorem says I can diagonalize that hat matrix. Oh, but what do I know about that hat matrix? Pop quiz for 200C. Symmetric and idempotent, which means that its eigenvalues are all 1 or 0. I actually know how many 1s I have, though, right? What's the rank of that?
n minus p, okay? So this thing has rank p, this thing has rank n minus p. So now I have an upper diagonal I that's n minus p by n minus p. That's how I can go back to this p, okay? So that's why I know it exists. Okay, good. So now, things are working out well for us. We're going to come up with this contrast matrix. It's going to happen. So if I look at B transpose times X, now that I can go find this B through the spectral decomposition theorem, that looks like I can say, oh, well, I'm just going to hit this quantity with B transpose times B, because all I've done is hit it by the identity. But now, what do I got in the middle? I've got something that looks like B transpose times I minus H times X. So if I take X and I distribute it across, I get X back here. And then when I hit H times X, I get X again, right? And so that whole thing. So far, so good. I don't know if I should tell you guys this or not, but I'm going to try and tell you to make you feel so happy about this. But you know, when I learned about this stuff, it's like, yeah, you use Rome, just try to reduce bias in the variance. That was the next slide. So, good to know where this stuff comes from, though. It's hard to find it, it's hard to write. So, now, something about what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, guys. Come on. Let's consider my U. That's the thing that I was getting back to. Now it's kind of obvious what I want it to be. That's going to be my, that B that I could find, transpose times Y. And let's note that if I look at U, again, much of what I just did, equal to B transpose times Y, that's equal to, oh, I'll do the same trick again, hit it by the identity, that's B transpose times B, times a B transpose times Y. Well, that becomes now B transpose times the identity minus H times Y. And so that's equal to B transpose. What do I get when I have that? I distribute this across, I get Y minus Y hat. So that's the residual, right? Residual. Talking so much about generalizing squarism. Actually, I'm going to call it beta hat. Yeah, it's like probably zero. It's the OLS estimate. I'm going to find it right now for you. I don't want to put I down there just because it's going to get confusing in a second. So beta hat zero is just the OLS estimator. And just as a historical note, maximum likelihood, but this is what we mean, the original derivation. Okay. So, now, equal to B transpose Z times B. That's my random effect vector, little b, plus B transpose times the residual in my model, with the expectation of U, we just now determined, because I've got this, this has mean zero, this has mean zero, equaling zero. So further, just to reemphasize this point, the distribution of U isn't going to depend upon beta. Okay? There's no beta floating around inside. So now, we kind of want to think about that S1 and S2 that I had when I derived or when I specified the marginal likelihood. So now let's consider the transformation where we're going to go from Y to U in what I'm going to call beta hat G, which is going to be our generalized least squares estimator. In other words, using the inverse of the variance covariance matrix as a weight transpose. And that thing is equal to, again, by definition, beta transpose Y. And again, I'm going to write this as G transpose Y, because the generalized estimator is just linear with Y. Right? So beta hat G is this G transpose times Y, which is X transpose sigma inverse X inverse X transpose sigma inverse Y. So that thing there is what I'm calling transpose, right? So it's the generalized least squares estimator. And so, just a quick note so we kind of make sure that we're honest here. The dimensions of G is an N by capital N by P, okay? Capital N is the length of Y. It's my full response vector there. Okay. This one, no, that's the true residual, right? This is the observed residual. This is like me taking Y, subtracting out X times beta hat, or getting that guy, okay? That's beta. This thing up here is the residual from the model, right here, residual. Good. Okay. So, what we need to do is we need to figure out the distribution of this thing, this transformation. So, 200A, what am I going to think about here? You're doing a transformation for Y to a library space. So we're going to have to compute the... What is 200? Qualifying exams coming soon. The Jacobian, right? You're going to need the Jacobian for that transformation? I think we're going to need the Jacobian for that transformation. Kyle, yeah? You feel good about that one? Yeah, Kyle's appraising. Yes. All right, so we're going to need the Jacobian of this transformation. So we'll write down our PDF, the change of variables times the Jacobian. Okay. So, note that the Jacobian of the transformation
Well, we're kind of lucky. I mean, we're kind of lucky and not so lucky. You guys probably haven't done transformations of vectors, so we got to deal with that. But it is nice because our transformation is just linear, right? I mean, it's the like.
It is given by.
Let's see. I'll call it determinant of J, or that's going to be the determinant of B U comma. B hat G, where I'm taking the determinant with respect to the log, or the derivative, sorry, with respect to the log. And so, oh, well, the nice thing is these are all linear, so that just looks like determinant of BG. And now this is where you're like, oh yeah, I remember that fact, right? So a couple of these things. So I can write that determinant, again, matrix, okay. And let's think about the dimensions here, right? So B is n by n minus p, yeah? And G is n by p. Looking on this? So now, I can take this thing and I can write it as B transpose G transpose. That's coming from the fact that the determinant of A transpose A, again, your study for your guys is 200C, the determinant of A squared, right? So that's all I'm doing there, I'm using that fact. So now, more interesting. So now I've got the determinant in this form. I'm going to write that as the following. B transpose B, determinant of that to the 1 half, times the determinant of G transpose G minus G transpose B times B transpose B. I'm going to put that in parentheses for a reason. Inverse times B transpose times G. All of the 1 half. So, for those of you that don't have this memorized, and I'm one of you, that's because we have this idea, right? In fact, by the way, on the T, I'm using the same old trick again, right? That's the same one that I used above, the A transpose. Okay. I mean, linear algebra is pretty cool. Yeah. There's a million and one facts about it. You need to be symmetric, idempotent. Once you get them all back, it's like, you get better out some stuff. Okay. So, that thing. That's the identity. I think it's the identity as well, right? That's how we constructed B to start off with. Okay. So now, oh, this is looking good. I know how to do a determinant of an identity. There's one thing I remember inside of my answer. So that's going to be a 1. Times, now I got a G transpose G minus a G transpose. Oh, I got a B times a B transpose. What's that? I minus H. Fantastic. Times a G. Things are looking up in the world. This is actually going to break down into, oops, I need a 1 half. And so this is going to break down into, I can drop that, simply a G transpose times an H G. Okay. But. And you guys gotta verify this for me. G transpose times H times G, you just gotta write it out really quickly to convince yourself. There's nothing more than your good old X transpose times X. again, double check to verify this based upon the generalized least squares estimator and half matrix for the overlaps. That's really important. So, now, are we having fun now, by the way? We're having fun, right? I'm having a great time up here. I just want to put that out there. If I think about now my transformed response vector, U and beta hat Q. Well, it's a bunch of linear combination of normals in this case, right? I've assumed the y's to be normal. So what do I know about this guy? It's normal. That's great. We got normality on our side, so that's good. So it's a linear combination of normals. Do you guys feel better about your 200C exam or more freaked out?
They don't want to say it out loud, but some people made a better choice this morning.
I've actually put this on it, parts of it. I've walked people through on a 200 C exam. So. I want. So that guy is normal as well. Great. So further. We will show. We're not quite there yet, folks. That the covariance between U and beta hat G, if you could choose anything in the world, what would you want that covariance to be?
Yeah.
Sure. Sum likelihood function for just U. It does not depend upon the